Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of Ask Jochen. This is our live stream lecture episode. So we do two live streams per month. One is a live stream lecture and one is a Q&A. So this month we have an excellent topic for you, which is all about the horse. So we're really excited to bring this topic to you. It's a very important one. And without any further ado, let's do our intro sequence and then we can welcome Jochen into the show for today. Hi, Jochen.
Hey, Mary Claire, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. I'm calling you from a remote area today. So I'm making sure that the camera will not take too much of the bandwidth. So,
no problem. Without further
ado, let's talk about saddle fit from the horse's point of view. Okay, let's do this, huh? I found this cartoon on the website. I had to chuckle and I thought I threw it in here. You know, my horse's back is killing me and I don't know why. I really have to wonder if the horse really does know, you know, because I believe many horses are suffering in silence. Or are they silent? You know, some are speaking loud and clear. You know, we have universities, many veterinarians, there's even pain scales out there, how we can learn as a horse owners, my horse is not happy. So sometimes, yeah, they just give up. They just stand there and they just said, you know, go ahead, put the saddle on me, take me into the stall for 23 hours, take me out for 1 hour and back I go. They just give in. So this psychological trauma and stress is well recorded and is well aware to the equine professionals, anywhere from the pinched or the sunken neck here, the thoracic sling. Look at all these wrinkles here in the neck. We all know what that means. The pain line on the shoulder, the holding line in the flank. So these are all very clear signs. The horse doesn't make them up because he doesn't like a girl or a boy or an English saddle or Western saddle, okay? The horse will deform. So one of the most important parts, what is really out there is that when you shop for your saddle, start with yourself first, because there is several recordings and shown fact that if a saddle doesn't fit you, it will never fit the horse and here goes the horse in pain again. So start with yourself first. There are 9 features in the seat you need to check. And this is, of course, we explain that in great deal in many of our other webinars. So once you have selected the right saddle, make sure you select the saddle where the horse will not give you a negative reaction. We have such a beautiful way of today. We don't have to wait anymore until the horse is dead. And then we dissect them and then we show you, see, I told you so. There's so many dissection classes. You can watch them even online now for free. And you can see how the muscle sling, the shoulder sling and the muscles and how thick the muscles are and how they all interact is fabulous. And there's trigger points on the horse. This one here, where my mouse is, this is a lung meridian point. If your saddle sits on that, the horse gets stressed. That's not my opinion. These are facts, right? It's the cartilage of the horse, that blue here you see on the top picture where my mouse is. If that's broken, it doesn't regrow. For thousands of years, people made saddles and then they have always way big weight-bearing surface. And then the English saddle got born. And when the English saddle got born, you can see here in this picture, they have the extenders in the back and the extenders in the front. Now, this was coming from the army time. And that was when we had our guns there, our water bottle, ropes, etc. in the back for package. Very important to notice, see how they swing up in the back. Doesn't matter if it's an English saddle or Western saddle, the back part of the saddle never was meant to sit in the lumbar area. Looking at the picture below here, that is where the horse will react to it. Again, that's not my opinion. That's not only happened on Western or English saddle. This happens because the horse doesn't like pressure. It's extremely painful to put pressure there. So here, these are the lumbar versus transfers. So these transfers are very, very thin, do not press her. So for over 7,000 years, human work with horses and saddles to make sure we have the optimal fit, not hurt these horses. And you see a very common pattern. It's always on top of the rib cage, but away from the spine, because the horse will react. Okay, the horse will react if you poke him. If you run your fingers along the spinal nerves, the entire back muscle, you can literally see how it's contracting, hollowing the back. Now it's bridging. Now it's in a frame where it's very painful for the horse. So the horse does that because of you hitting, I like to call these landmines, right? If you step on a landmine, an explosion. On the horse's explosion, in the back, the horse bucks, runs away. Here, they drop the back, and sometimes it's so painful, they run away. Their buck, that's the way they can defend themselves. You know, the horse is not a fighting animal. So how do they react in pain and stress? They run away. Here in the front, the wither cup, so vulnerable. Okay, so in 35 million years, the stallion bites there. So the horse, even if you never had a saddle on this horse, every horse will hollow their back, drop the rib cage, raises the head up, and the horse, what has a little bit less pain tolerance, will swing the head around and says, I'm not gonna like this. This is very painful, and then bites you. So you wonder when you girth up the saddle, why the horse turns around and bites you. This is not somebody's opinion. This is a horse opinion. Horses are absolutely absolutely masters in hiding pain. Because if I show pain, I get eaten. So for 35 million years, horses have mastered the skill of hiding pain. Otherwise, I get picked from the predator to be eaten. So I don't want that. So when the horse reacts, when you come with your girth in the saddle, you better figure out something, because it's already way above the pain tolerance. I will go in later in my tolerance, in my webinar, where I show you how you can recognize the saddle signs, because many veterinarians and universities already have it done for us, right? It's so many beautiful articles and videos. It's all for free. We just need to look at it, but we shouldn't ignore it. So every time we look at this, remember, it has to fit you first, then the horse. Where on the horse? Not on the cartilage, not on the lung meridian point, not on the wither cup, spinal nerves, lumbar, and your girth should never hit any of these edges, the pectoralis or the latissimus. Very, very important. So here's a good example where the saddle, clearly you see the ring of lights, you see the red ring, this is the lumbar spurs processes. You do not want to push on that, okay? So if I have to choose too short, okay, too long, clearly the saddle is way too long. So that's absolutely horrible. Many, many top riders who also are veterinarians have pointed out numerous times, if the horse curls up, if you curl the horse up, if you put the horse in the false frame, no matter which term you want to use, the horse will get very fast, very sore. Some of the veterinarians have even gone so far that this says, okay, I swore do no harm to the horses. So what am I doing? All I do is injecting steroids in the joint, in the horse, burn the nerves to hide the pain so the rider can continue riding the horse in their competition. That's not what I signed up for it. So they will speak up what causes this. They will help the customer. And some of them so frustrated, they quit their job. Some of them, suicide. I wonder why so many veterinarians have such a high suicide rate. Many reasons. I'm not saying it's because of saddle fit. I'm saying because of us as humans sometimes think, oh, that's normal. What is normal? I had a wonderful, wonderful webinar just hours ago with a beautiful horsewoman who wrote a great book, The Different Sides of Horsemanship. Her name is Shelby Dennis. We've done many symposiums with her or webinars, and she made a very good point. She says, what we think is normal is not normal. For us to turn around and see this horse is actually in pain takes a brave person to say, okay, I'm going to change that. This type of behavior is not normal just because some people abuse the system and audience who have not seen when the horse is in pain. All these horses in pain and ridden in such a frame that hurts the horse. So the horse will then be ridden in the saddle, which is now bridging because the horse's back is completely hollow. Never mind what it does to the joints and the tendons. So we see this over and over again in all different sports. Horses say, enough, I want to get out of here. I don't like it. Oh, you know, he was spooking from the fence. And these are signs which we're all too familiar with. And I don't want to dwell on too much on it, but these horses are simply not happy. So we've seen horses deformed in the body, on the spine. We see nasty veins popping out left, right, center. And sometimes, you know, we ignore that horses, just like humans, they maybe can be born with a deficiency. So if you look at the transitional vertebrae, it's not too uncommon that you see this is a lumbar right here on one side is normal, this is abnormal. Normally the nerve goes down here, but on the transitional vertebrae, it's sitting on top, very sensitive. So this horse is very, very uneven. Some horses are born where the ribs, the first two ribs are not even. They're calcified and they're born with being together. So the horse can be uneven or in the upper arm. So don't stress yourself and says, oh my God, I got to euthanize. I don't know this horse because he's crooked or he has this deformity. I don't know, in many saddle fitting clinics in the UK, and I met one of the veterinarians who is an endurance rider. I'm sorry, an event rider. And he says, I'm doing often vet checks at the event. And sometimes I see such a crooked horse, says, oh my God, this horse should not go in the event, but he's completely sound. So just because you're crooked or the horse is crooked doesn't mean you can't perform. The takeaway message is that the equipment, what goes on these horses, have to be adapted. We call them orthopedic saddle fitting, to the abnormality of the horse. Horses are always even. They eat uneven. The organs are uneven. They stand uneven. We as a rider put artificial weight on the horse's back, and that will damage either the left side or the right side. Most of the time it goes from the small joints to the big joints where they fall apart. So what can I do as a good rider, as a good trainer? I can sit symmetric on the horse. But what if I'm not listening to the message from my horse? What if my saddle just falls in one side and egoistic me think, oh yeah, I'm going to strain the bone straight. Good luck. How are you going to do that? So you're just going to go ahead and beat on your horse or trying to get this horse into a frame? Of course not, right? So you get your saddle adjusted properly so the horse can have even pressure on the legs and hopefully get the back up to the haunches, the hind leg come underneath and the horse is lighter in the front. And that's really what we want. If not, you keep pinching the cranial nerve 11, okay? And it shows you clearly here, nice pain line. Some veterinarian put that on the front of their books they have published about horses in pain and saddle fitting. You know, there's other articles from other veterinarians and doctors where they're showing how this pain, yeah, it goes all the way down to the feet, you know, when there's compression between the scapula and the ribs. You know, we're talking about right there is this massive brachial plexus. So these are just scientific facts. And on the horse, you can see it. You know, you can see when they get pinched, He again clearly outlined the cranial nerve 11 and all this here. Okay. So there is an old saying, it takes a village. It takes a village to raise a child. You know, it takes an army to keep a horse sound. So I think the takeaway message here, today's webinar is saddle fitting from the horse's point of view, is sometimes the horse is already stressed because of the way it's been managed. You know, horses in nature walk 20 miles a day. So you can have a good comparison, and Shelby explained that beautiful. She had a mare, was on the racetrack 23 hours a day in the stall, was riding an hour a day, and the horse had all kinds of behavior issue. Changed the management, the horse was on the 24-hour paddock. Guess what? That horse didn't buck, didn't bulge, nothing. The whole attitude changed because the horse could move around. Now, what I'm saying is not that you take every horse out of the stall and put them in the pasture. Of course, that would be great and nice for every horse, but I understand it's not always realistic. So we need to look at the whole horse approach. If I cannot do that, where I put my horse 24 hours on a large paddock, what can I do? Can I get him out? Can I get him moving a lot? Can I get him in paddocks? And if I do not have the luxury or cannot do that where I live or my horse lives, then we need to understand when a horse is trapped in a tiny little room, the horse needs to get out, get moving, do everything a little bit slower. What would you think if you are in the little powder room all day where you barely can move, and then you come out and you have to do your best athletic performance and carry weight, but probably pokes you in the back as well. So saddle fit is a massive, massive problem maker, because depends on which environment the horse is, how bad his hoofs is, teeth, or his other body conformation, the back is either hollow or up. And when the horse stresses and tries to hide the pain, the saddle emphasizes the issue. It makes it even worse. So what is the real takeaway point here? The takeaway point is a horse doesn't have an opinion if you believe in one of the nine saddle fitting methods it's taught worldwide. How ridiculous is that? How ridiculous is that there's so many saddle fitting schools out there and there are nine different ones? There should be only one. One saddle fitting. And the one saddle fitting comes from the point of view of the horse. And if we base it on science and nature, then there is no more question which of the nine saddle fitting opinions is the right one. I mean, we got so many articles, as I mentioned earlier here, the Boehringer Ingelheim institution published the equine pain scale. You know, they got 1 to 4. 0 to 1, it's no pain. Then you got the 2, pain in the face is present. And then you got the intensive pain. I mean, this is all online, folks, and you can download it and get to know your horse. Recognize how the horse is when he's in the paddock with his pals and hanging out there, when he's not in pain, doesn't have colic, doesn't have ulcer, doesn't have any other issues. How does his body look like? So if we turn to science and we say, okay, at what time, at how much pressure does the muscle loses the oxygen flow, the nutrition? At what time does the capillaries closure actually happens? So this is at 4.66 kPa. In Europe, they use kilopascal. In North America, we use pounds per square inch. So if we know if the saddle does not disturb it over a minimum of 120 square inch, your weight and the saddle's weight, the horse will have massive problems, pain. They go to extents where they put the spine into a machine and see at what stage does the bone give up. I mean, we go on and we see all this research to the part where some universities even attack the modern saddle making, you know, where they say this is so ridiculous when the horse canters on the horse on the bottom right. That's from the university. This is actually the German National Riding School in Barndorf. This horse has even a name, Foxtrot. And this is Dr. Gerd Scheuchmann's contribution. And he talks about this horse a lot. So here in the canter, you see how the back is up. But if there is no saddle tree in the middle anymore, and the saddle does not get lifted from the center up, how can the shoulder, you see the shoulder blade, which has a lot of cartilage damage, how can the shoulder move freely under saddle if the saddle is bridging? You see in this thermography on the top, massive pressure on the gullet plate and the stirrup bar we see. We see universities papers showing the insertion of the spinalis right here where that gullet plate and the stirrup bar is. You know, you want the longissimus dorsi, the longest muscle, nice and stretchy, so the back can come up. Highest pressure always in the front. Why? Because the trees get narrower and narrower, and we forget the number one rule, weight distribution. I think one of the biggest spokesperson for horses, it is by far Sue Dyson, and she has wonderful, I have a link there, wonderful videos and facial expression. I can only encourage everybody to Google this, start to learn your horse, because I didn't, you know, and for some of you folks who know me, you know the story, and for you folks who are first time you listen to this, you know, I grew up on horses. And I became a certified master saddler. And then later on, unfortunately too late, a saddle ergonomist. What's the difference between a master saddler and a saddle ergonomist? A certified master saddler makes saddles from start to finish, but not necessarily has the ability to learn and knows the anatomy of horse and rider, neither the physiology, biomechanics, and how all this works in motion, static, is one thing, but the saddle has to fit in movement, right? There's 9 different shapes of the back when the horse moves. I didn't learn that in making a saddle. 8 years, 3 years apprenticeship, 5 years journeyman, and then I became a master. So in the saddle ergonomist, you learn all this. You can learn that at Saddle Fit for Life. I highly recommend you check that out, saddlefitforlifeacademy.com. My claim to fame was that I was riding on the German team as a 3-day event rider. And my shame is that I didn't listen to him. I listened to the old masters who says, just keep him making forward. Don't let the horse get away with that. Rather than to build a partnership. Needless to say, eventually the horse suffered in silence. That's why I wrote this book, Horses Suffering in Silence. This saddle fit linked to psychological, physical trauma in horses. No, why? Because there's so many opinion of saddle fit. Why don't we make it easy? Why don't we just listen to the horse? Okay. If you don't understand the horse, look at the scientific facts. Careful with people who are sponsored in saddles. There's nothing wrong with sponsored riders. Okay, so we do that too at Schleese, but we pick people who listen to the horse, who don't beat the horse silly in submission. We listen to people, we like to work with people who put the horse first. You know, there's a lot of fashionable things out, but please follow the nature. There is gravity on this planet. Somewhere the saddle will make contact. It doesn't hover above the horse unless you go with our new incredible Saddle, which we call the therapeutic panel, and soon a new saddle. But in majority, the saddle will go and sit on the horse's back. It has to place weight somewhere. Don't go with people who have just big authority and forces and poses will to you. And the biggest plea I have, don't turn into a person who says, oh, nothing works anyway, and just sweet talk anything, and you turn into a cognitive dissonance person. You know, more padding is not the answer. Also not the answer is to make the horse's back completely numb. Okay, so this is this first defense mechanism. The horse's skin is the largest organ. And when we start to go with injections and all kinds of things, this is not the way to treat the horse when they tell you, I'm not happy. You know, if I'm in pain, okay, every time you come with your saddle, it makes it even worse. Figure out where the pain comes from. And by just making the area numb, it's not the issue. The takeaway message here, saddle fitting does not exist. You can't just buy a saddle and then it fits, because nature has never meant for us as humans to sit on the horse. You know, so what am I talking then? Saddle fitting from the perspective of the horse's eye. You know, saddle fitting is an ongoing process to continue to align the horizontal spine with the human vertical spine without causing discomfort to both, with natural to us both as naturally constantly change. You know, both human and horse, there's always changes. I know human hate changes, but babies, they don't mind changes. But in general, we don't like it. So this is why we decided to go with Saddle Fit for Life for the first time ever. It's going to be a massive event. We're so excited to look at this. So we look at from all partners so that we really listen to the horses, so the horses don't have to be in pain anymore. People understand why the old masters always brought the back up, haunches underneath, so the horse can be in contact to lift up the rider and the saddle so they don't damage the horse, to able to get the haunches underneath, because you do the same thing. If you have a sore back, you will not perform to your fullest ability. A horse needs to get his legs, his hind legs underneath the sternum in order to get over a jump, to do the canter period, sliding stop, whatever you fancy to ride. Riding the horse as B is not an option. But I can ride a horse in the same lesson, like A, like B. I can make him go on the forehand or off the forehand. If you buy saddles with plastic trees or plastic tree, wood trees, or carbon fiber, you know, they're not meant to move. Right, they're light, but they are not flexible. So our adapt trees at Schleese, we make sure they have the flexibility. So for your most important aid, your seat, your weight will follow the shape. So please be aware that the horse can carry you well. Okay, you can have gated horses, gated saddles without creating pain if you're sitting away from these landmines, as I discussed in the beginning. So as we come to the end of the seminar, the main thing is we must avoid pain and damage to the horses with ill-fitting saddles by following signs and not opinions. I like this. I got this from our sales manager, Odia. She sends me this and says, hey, you should show this. This is really cool. If you are not a scientist and you disagree with scientists about science, is actually not a disagreement. You just wrong. Science is not truth. Science is finding the truth. When science changes its opinion, it didn't lie to you. It learned more. So while we see sometimes new anatomy comes out, big pictures. Sometimes more information comes out. right? Just because they didn't know that before, that doesn't mean the old folks like myself, veterinarians, body workers who haven't progressed with their fitting. So my point here is make sure your saddle fitter continues their license and recertify. I love working together with veterinarians who also talk about the proper saddle fit and proper training to understand that the longest muscle needs to stay supple and be round in order for the horse to engage the back. As I said before, and as veterinarians, as schools for 400 years old preach all over the world, the rider needs to fit the saddle first. If you don't have a perpendicular line, shoulder, hips, and heels, you're not achieve a pliable seat. And without a pliable seat, the horse will suffer. So hopefully you do the same thing as I did. I surrounded myself with experts around the world when it comes to biomechanics, physiology, etc., because I wanted to make sure I want to protect horses that don't have any more long-term damage. And I want to make sure they're staying away from all these nasty spinal injuries. Listen to the horse's sign. They will make it very clear what they do and don't like. It's written down in many aspects. We don't have to make these horses and deform the horses. So at this stage, I want to thank you very much for listening to the seminar. And from the horse's mouth, thank you for listening to me. You and I don't have to be in pain if you stop following opinions and look at and follow science and the law of nature.
Wonderful lecture. Thank you so much, Jochen. That was amazing. Such an important one this month. So I hope you guys enjoyed that. Thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you on the next one.
Thank you, Mary Claire. See you soon.
Thank you. Thank you.